Gracias, buenas tardes. Okay, we're going to talk today about how to do hair transplant. You're going to learn how to do it in 10 minutes. No, I'm just joking. But we're going to go through some philosophy and some principles out there. The first thing we have to understand is that the basis of the modern hair transplant is transferring the follicular unit. As most of you probably already know, hair does not grow in single units, but they grow in clusters of 1, 2, 3, and 4 hairs. That's very, very important. And those discrete clusters are what forms the basis of modern hair restoration today. So how I do it? Let's break down the step 1, 2, 3, 4 and how to do it from beginning to end. I'm writing a new book that will detail all this that will come out probably in January of next year. It's already signed, the book deal. So after the hairline design, we're not going to go through all that today. The occiput is shaved, and I really like level 2 anesthesia. I like to knock off that edge so the patients don't have any discomfort. So just an intravenous combination of midazolam and fentanyl. And then I use a ring block just below where I'm going to harvest and just in front of my recipient area. So a ring block circumferentially around the head using about 20 cc's of simple 1% lidocaine with 100,000 epinephrine. The recipient site tumescence, we're going to talk more about the importance of tumescence if that's not part of your practice. This is one of the most single important things I can tell you today is tumesce for both the recipient and the donor site. And I'm going to explain to you why that's so important in the coming slide. Here it is. Let's think about the donor site as like a ship over corals. The ship is the hair follicle, and the coral is all the nerves and the blood supply. You want to tumesce all those hairs far, 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 far away from your nerve and blood supply and only take your blade tips just past the follicles. And I spend 20 minutes tumescing that bed so that it's a tense, taut bed. The other reason is that you get a much cleaner harvest because all your hairs are lined up in straight instead of bending in different directions. So remember, tumesce about 100 to 200 cc's of saline tumescence with a little bit of lidocaine mix, and you see the mixture up there. That will truly help you harvest safely so you don't get those problems with long-term neuromas and pain that you can get if you just cavalierly cut through the donor site. You're going to go ahead and I do this first. Is what I do is I take a microserrated scissors and I just trim about a millimeter off the bottom lip. It's the bottom lip, not the top lip, all the way across. And as you close that wound, you get a trochophytic closure. This is popularized by Patrick Fauché of France. And really what's so amazing with this is in the majority of cases you can't find your scar because the hairs grow through the incision. So it's a wonderful technique. I close with a 3-0 nylon suture. After you finished with the closure, you go ahead and give them 0.25% marcaine, and that allows you to have enough anesthesia for even throughout the procedure and into the night when they can feel a little tightness that night from the donor closure. The recipient is also an area that must be tumesced. If you hear a tap, if the patient hears a tapping noise during the recipient site creation, you have no tumescence in there. You're damaging blood supply, you're damaging nerve supply, and it's not good. And the best thing to do when I do the tumescence is you do it sequentially over the area you're going to be working on. So I'll put about 10 or 20 cc's into the area that I'm working with and then advance that tumescence as I continue. The plane is simply in the subcutaneous plane. So your patient shouldn't hear tapping, you shouldn't hear tapping, and you should be very, very deliberate in your site creations, which we're going to talk about more in a moment right here. The key with this of bad hair restoration is not understanding how hair grows. You must understand how the hairline grows, how it differs from a female hairline, and all that. It's so critical. So following each of those patterns, they're low angled hairs, not up like this, very low, about 15 to 20 degrees down, tightly interlocked, and that's so important. These are just a schematic of the different types of areas of the scalp, which mandates different recipient site creations, different angles, just different distributions. Let's talk about showing a schematic using the multiple unit grafts and the follicular unit grafts, how to do that together. The larger grafts that comprise 2 or 3 follicular units, you should start with those first to build the central density, because it's much easier once you're done with that to interlock the smaller grafts in front of them. The other way around, very, very hard. The other reason is that you want to build the hairline forward. You don't want to build the hairline back, because the hairline has just sort of broken like a coastline, where from a distance the coastline looks straight, but up close it's craggy with little eddies and jetties that come out, and that's what you want to do. So building from your larger sites, larger grasp forward creates a very natural appearing hairline. This is showing you the vertex or crown. You want to mimic a crown, so this is all lovingly recreated with a swirl that blends up toward the back of the parietal region and into the mid scalp. You want this all to be seamlessly blending and to recreate the angles that occur in a natural hair. If you don't know this, go look at someone with a closely shorn head and look at how that hair grows. You must understand how hair grows before you can design it. Female hairlines are very different from male hairlines. Oftentimes, they're the exact opposite. We talked earlier about male hairlines growing forward and low. Female hairlines oftentimes grow up and back with a swirl. It's the exact opposite. If you actually pay attention and look at a female hairline, you will see that it's not just an exercise of creating sights, it's an exercise of creating beauty and mimicking nature. That's what's so important when you do this. Here are some quick results. You can see what I've used there in the listing. 46-year-old Chinese gentleman. These are all one-session treatments. And you can see the density we can achieve that's very natural. And it's extremely important when you're dealing with Asian hair to stay low because of the thick caliber and straight nature of that hair against a paler scalp. Another example of a Chinese hair restoration, we do about 30% ethnic work. This is a female hairline. You can also see the cowlick that I recreated, the swirl. I worked to bring down the frame of the temples. This is so important, especially when you're dealing with African American, some degree with Asians, but Caucasian gentlemen should have a more suppressed hairline, and also obviously designed in the context of their natural shaped head. For example, here you can see we've brought back that taper of the frontal temporal recession to make it look natural for him with that craggy, jutted, sort of a hairline that comes forward like a coastline. You can see this gentleman on the left underwent almost looks like pubic hair because it's too straight and there's no density. The angles are too high. And the reason for this is that the grafts have been overly manipulated by the graft dissection team and placement team. So unlike your rhinoplasty where everything is your hands, you are only 30% of the equation when you do hair restoration. It's like building a car. If your team is bad, your results are unequivocally bad. You must have a great team. You must have a dedicated team. And that's a correction you can see with one session. These are all one session. What's the problem with the hairline here? Well, too straight, too high, just like the last one. But in addition to that, there's pitting. You can see the little holes there. The grafts are placed at the surface or just below the surrounding recipient sites. You need to place that slightly higher, so that's not good. By the way, my next talk is a little shorter, so we're going to go over a little bit over. This is, again, too straight, too high, and badly angled. You can see they look like grafts coming in. You got to take those and lower them. And the way that I straighten this to conserve grafts, you can go in there and just put a little widow's peak. It breaks the flow of that natural hairline and it offsets some of that without necessarily needing a lot of grafts for that. That's what's so great about a little widow's peak in a gentleman. This is a gentleman. These are all one session treatments. You can see without multiple unit grafts, you're really not going to create the density with one session, and you're going to transect a lot of these white hairs that you're working with. In my opinion, it's the standard of care almost. I wouldn't want to go too far with that when you're dealing with white hair for multiple unit grafts. In quick conclusion, I think MUGs in the right hands can be absolutely powerful in achieving incredible density without sacrificing naturalness in a single session. These are all single session work. The key with this is understanding not just, you know, a lot of times as facial plastic surgeons or plastic surgeons, we dismiss hair as a mechanical exercise. It's anything but. It is an incredibly creative labor of love. And if you don't have that passion, do not go into hair restoration. I have that level of passion. And with MUGs, multiple unit grafts, I think you can get incredible density if you use it well and pick your candidates well. Thank you.